Bantam Doubleday Dell Audio Publishing presents The Incredible Journey by Sheila Burnford. The Beasts. I think I could turn and live with animals. They are so placid and self-contained. I stand and look at them long and long. They do not sweat and whine about their condition. They do not lie awake in the dark and weep for their sins. They do not make me sick discussing their duty to God. Not one is dissatisfied. Not one is demented with the mania of owning things. Not one kneels to another, nor to his kind that lived thousands of years ago. Not one is respectable or industrious over the whole earth. Walt Whitman, Leaves of Grass, Song of Myself, verse 32. Chapter 1. This journey took place in a part of Canada which lies in the northwestern part of the great sprawling province of Ontario. It is a vast area of deeply wooded wilderness, of endless chains of lonely lakes and rushing rivers, thousands of miles of country roads, rough timber lanes, overgrown tracks leading to abandoned mines, and unmapped trails snake across its length and breadth. It is a country of far-flung, lonely farms and a few widely scattered small towns and villages, of lonely trappers' shacks and logging camps. Most of its industry comes from the great pulp and paper companies who work their timber concessions deep in the very heart of the forests, and from the mines, for it is rich in minerals. Prospectors work through it. There are trappers and Indians, and sometimes hunters who fly into the virgin lakes in small amphibious aircraft. There are pioneers with visions beyond their own lifespan, and there are those who have left the bustle of civilization forever to sink their identity in an unquestioning acceptance of the wilderness. But all these human beings together are as a handful of sand upon the ocean shores, and for the most part there is silence and solitude and an uninterrupted way of life for the wild animals that abound there. Moose and deer, brown and black bears, lynx and fox, beaver, muskrat and otter, fishers, mink and marten. The wild duck rests there and the Canada goose, for this is a fringe of the central migratory flyway. The clear, tree-fringed lakes and rivers are filled with speckled trout and steelheads, pike and pickerel and whitefish. Almost half the year the country is blanketed with snow, and for weeks at a time the temperature may stay many degrees below zero. There is no slow growth of spring, but a sudden short burst of summer when everything grows with wild abandon, and as suddenly it is the fall again. To many who live there, fall is the burnished crown of the year, with the crisp, sunny days and exhilarating air of the Northland, with clear blue skies and drifting leaves, and as far as the eye can see, the endless panorama of glorious, rich, flaming color in the turning trees. This is the country over which the three travelers passed, and it was in the fall that they traveled, in the days of Indian summer. John Longridge lived several miles from one of the small towns in an old stone house that had been in his family for several generations. He was a tall, austerely pleasant man of about 40, a bachelor and a writer by profession, being the author of several historical biographies. He spent much of his time traveling and gathering material for his books, but always returned to the comfortable old stone house for the actual writing. He liked the house to himself during these creative periods, and for many years had enjoyed an ideal arrangement whereby his domestic wants were cared for by a middle-aged couple, Mrs. Oakes and her husband Bert, who lived in a small cottage about half a mile away. Mrs. Oakes came in every day to look after the house and cook the main meals. Bert was in charge of the furnace, the garden, and all the odd jobs. They came and went about their business without disturbing Longridge, and there was complete accord among them all. On the eve of the incredible journey, towards the end of September, Longridge sat by a crackling long fire in his comfortable library. The curtains were drawn, and the firelight flickered and played on the bookshelves and danced on the ceiling. The only other light in the room came from a small shaded lamp on a table by the deep armchair. It was a very peaceful room, and the only sound was the occasional crackling from the logs or the rustling of a newspaper, the pages of which Longridge turned with some difficulty, for a slender, wheat-colored Siamese cat was curled on his knee, chocolate-colored front paws curved in towards one another, sapphire eyes blinking occasionally as he stared into the fire. On the floor, his scarred, bony head resting on one of the man's feet, lay an old white English bull terrier. His slanted almond-shaped eyes, sunk deep within their pinkish rims, were closed. One large triangular ear caught the firelight, flushing the inside a delicate pink, so that it appeared almost translucent. Anyone accustomed to the rather peculiar points of bull terrier beauty would have thought him a strange, if not downright ugly, dog, with the naked down-faced arc of his profile, his deep-chested, stocky body and whip-tapered tail. But the true lover of an ancient and honorable breed would have recognized the blood and bone of this elderly and rather battered body, would have known that in his prime this had been a magnificent specimen of compact sinew and muscle, bred to fight and endure, and would have loved him for his curious mixture of wicked, unyielding fighter, yet devoted and docile family pet, and above all, for the irrepressible air of sly merriment which gleamed in his little slant eyes. He twitched inside often in his sleep, as old dogs will, and for once his shabby tail with the bare patch on the last joint was still. By the door lay another dog, nose on paws, brown eyes open and watchful, in contrast to the peacefulness radiated by the other occupants of the room. This was a large red gold Labrador retriever, a young dog with all the heritage of his sturdy working forebears in his powerful build, broad noble head and deep, blunt, gentle mouth. He lifted his head as Longridge rose from the chair, depositing the cat with an apologetic pat on the floor, and carefully moving his foot from under the old dog's head before walking across the room to draw one of the heavy curtains and look out. A huge orange moon was rising just above the trees at the far end of the garden, and a branch of an old lilac tree tap-tapped in the light wind against the window pane. It was bright enough outside to see the garden in clear detail, and he noticed how the leaves had drifted again across the lawn, even in the short time since it had been raked that afternoon, and that only a few brave asters remained to color the flower beds. He turned and crossed the room, flicking on another light, and opened a narrow cupboard halfway up the wall. Inside were several guns on racks, and he looked at them thoughtfully, running his fingers lovingly down the smooth grain of the hand-rubbed stocks, and finally lifted down a beautifully chased and engraved double-barrel gun. He broke it and peered down the gleaming barrels, and as though at a signal, the young dog sat up silently in the shadows, his ears pricked in interest. The gun fell back into place with a well-oiled click, and the dog whined. The man replaced the gun in sudden contrition, and the dog lay down again, his head turned away, his eyes miserable. Longridge walked over to make amends for his thoughtlessness, but as he bent down to pat the dog, the telephone rang so suddenly and shrilly in the quiet room that the cat jumped indignantly off the chair, and the bull terrier started clumsily to his feet. Longridge picked up the receiver, and presently the breathless voice of Mrs. Oakes was heard, accompanied by a high-pitched whining note in the distance.
"Speak up, Mrs. Oakes. I can hardly hear you." "I can hardly hear you either," said the breathless voice distantly. "There, is that better? I'm shouting now. What time are you leaving in the morning, Mr. Longridge? What's that? Could you talk louder?"
"About 7 o'clock. I want to get to Heron Lake before nightfall," he shouted, noting with amusement the scandalized expression of the cat. "But there's no need for you to be here at that time, Mrs. Oakes."
"What's that you said? 7? Will it be all right if I don't come in until about 9? My niece is coming on the early bus and I'd like to meet her, but I don't like to leave the dogs alone too long."
"Of course you must meet her," he answered, shouting really loudly now as the humming noise increased. "The dogs will be fine. I'll take them out first thing in the morning, and—"
"Oh, thanks, Mr. Longridge. I'll be there around 9 without fail. What's that you said about the animals?"
"Oh, you pernickety, dratted old line. Don't you worry about them. Bert and me, we'll see that they're all... Tell old Bodger I'm bringing the marrow bone.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.